Okay, so we got this fountain question. We're saying a fountain with an opening of radius 0.015 meters shoots a stream of water vertically from the ground level at 6 meters per second. The density of water is good old 1,000 kilograms per meters cubed. We want to say calculate the volume flow rate of the water. So we know that we have this idea that volume flow rate is something that is conserved within our system, within our flowing fluid. We don't directly have an equation for the volume flow rate. We can call it Q if we want. It's equal to our volume per time, how much volume is flowing in this pipe over some amount of time. And because we're dealing with an amount of volume, this volume flow rate is constant throughout our pipe, regardless of what change we're going with, because the volume that we have into our pipe has to equal the volume that we have coming out of our pipe. If we ended up with more volume at the end of our pipe, or if we ended up with less volume, that'd be kind of weird. We know that mass is conserved, and by default, because we're dealing with this density is mass per volume, if our mass is conserved, then if we have a constant density, then our volume is conserved as well. So we're dealing with this conserved volume and then conserved mass, which is really dictated by our continuity equation. This idea that mass is conserved, and this area times velocity is equal to the area times velocity anywhere throughout a pipe. This A times V is our volume flow rate. So if we're looking at this question A, our volume flow rate is going to equal the area times the velocity. And we know stuff about the area, and we know stuff about the velocity. We know that at the opening, the radius is 0.1, or sorry, 0.015 meters. So we know that the area is pi r squared. And the velocity is equal to 6 meters per second. So we can say our volume flow rate is equal to pi times 0.015 squared times 6. So our volume flow rate is 0.015, 0.00135 pi. Or we could call it 0.00424 meters cubed per second. And then one quick little tip. This volume per time equaling area times velocity is not on the equation sheet, but we can think about it in terms of units. We know that our area per volume, or sorry, our units for volume is meters cubed. We know that our units for time is seconds. So our units for area is meters squared. Our units for velocity is meters per second. When we put those together, we get meters cubed per second. So just a little helpful tip, if you forget volume flow rate, we can rely on our units. So this is 0.00135 pi. The fountain is fed by a pipe that at one point has a radius of 0.025 meters and is 2.5 meters below the fountain's opening. Calculate the absolute pressure in the point at this pipe. So we have this situation over here. I'm going to call this below. I'm going to call this above. So I'm going to call this point A. I'm going to call this point B. So we're saying this is kind of the lowest that we're going to go. So I'm going to call this a height of 0 meters. I'm going to call this a height of 2.5 meters. 2.5 meters above it. All right, and I want to know, and this has, sorry, a radius of 0.025 meters. So I want to know the pressure at point B. So what I can do is I can, and I want to know the absolute pressure. So I'm going to set up Bernoulli's equation, say the pressure at A plus the kinetic energy at A plus the gravitational potential energy at A, that's supposed to be at Y, is equal to the pressure at point B plus the kinetic energy at point B, below point, plus the height at point B. And we defined the height at point B to just be equal to 0. So we can start plugging in what we know. We know that the pressure at A, if you look at this, we are just out in the open here. We're out in the air. So we're dealing with atmospheric pressure at point A. We know that at the same depth or the same height, whichever way we want to think about it. The amount of pressure is the same anywhere at that height, anywhere at that location. I don't know why I drew there. But so this A is right at what we're going to call sea level. So we're going to say the absolute pressure at point A. Why is this freaking out? Okay. So we can plug in PA. It's just going to be atmospheric pressure because it's just out in the open. So 1.0 times 10 to the fifth pascals. We said that the velocity at A is going to equal 6 plus 1,000 times 9.8 times a height of 2.5 above zero. PB, we want to solve for. All right, so we don't know the velocity at B, but we do know the volume flow rate throughout this whole entire fluid is 0.00135 pi. So we do know about B that this volume flow rate is conserved, so the area B times the velocity of B has to equal 0.00135. So 0.00135 pi, or pi, yeah, I forgot a pi. It's pi. The radius is 0.025. We can cancel out a pi, and we find that the velocity of point B has to equal 2.16 meters per second. All right, so we can plug in 2.16 up here, and we end up with a pressure of 1.4. And so we end up with a pressure at B from doing that math of 140167.2 pascals. And if we're checking to see if that makes sense, it looks like it does because over here we have a smaller velocity, right? 2.16 versus 6. So the velocity term is bigger, the height term is bigger, which means that our pressure term has to be bigger to compensate for that, to make sure that we have this equality. And then one other thing just to kind of look at, we wanted to find the absolute pressure at PB. So we plugged in absolute pressure and we got out absolute pressure. If we plugged in gauge pressure, we would have got out gauge pressure. Just a little reminder about that, we say the absolute pressure is equal to the gauge pressure plus the atmospheric pressure. So what we really looked at was, like, if we plugged in just gauge pressure without considering atmospheric pressure, we really have this additive term over here, so gauge at A plus atmospheric at A. So that means that we ended up with gauge at B and atmospheric pressure at B. So we really ended up with that absolute pressure because we're plugging in kind of both these terms. So we end up with both those terms. Because if we were solving it out, we'd have like minus this and then minus and then plus and all that good stuff. But yeah, that wasn't super helpful, but you know what I mean? So we plug in atmospheric, we get out atmospheric, we put in gauge, we would have gotten out gauge. And then C, we're saying the fountain owner wants to launch the water 4 meters into the air with the same volume flow rate. What nozzle can we attach so that we can get the, or what radius can we get so that we can get it to go 4 meters? So if we're looking at this, we're saying, okay, we have this fountain, and we can look at, we can consider one little piece of water. This water has some sort of velocity coming out of the top, and then it reaches some sort of height, and we want it to be a height of 4 meters in the air. So what we're really looking at, this is a kinematics question. So this is us saying, hey, we want to have the same volume flow rate of 0.00135 pi equals area times velocity, 0.00135 pi is equal to pi r squared velocity. And I'm going to call this V naught. This is really our initial velocity for the launch of this water. If we're looking at this and kind of like looking at what kinematics variables we can think about, this is kinematics, we need to know this V naught so we can find this R. So we can use kinematics to do that. So we know that V naught is what we want to find. If we're looking at it, we have this piece of water that's thrown up in the air. And the highest point, we remember back from our physics before, that the highest point, the velocity is equal to zero. If you're throwing a ball up in the air, it reaches some highest point, it has to turn around once it reaches that highest point. In order to turn around, you have to come to rest. You have to stop in order to change directions. So we have this final velocity of 0 meters per second. We see that the initial height is 0 meters, but the final height that we want is equal to 4 meters. We also know that this is just an object in the air with no other forces acting on it, so the acceleration is negative 9.8 meters per second squared. So we may not remember our kinematics equations, and that's okay, that's why we get an equation sheet. So in the AP Physics 2 equation sheet, we have these kinematics equations. So if we're looking at this one, this first one doesn't look very helpful because we don't know anything about the time, so that whole term we can't use. Same with the second one, we don't know anything about the time, so we can't use that term. But this last one, we have this final velocity squared equals our initial velocity squared plus 2 times our acceleration times our displacement. So this works well for our case. We know that the final velocity is 0. The initial velocity is what we want to solve for. We know that the acceleration is negative 9.8, and our displacement that we want is 4 meters. So we solve this, V0 squared is equal to 2 times 9.8 times 4. So then when we solve that out, we get 78.4. So our velocity is 8.85 meters per second. And we're almost done. But we don't want the velocity, we want the radius. But we said we can use this volume flow rate equation. So we say the volume flow rate is constant, so the area times the velocity has to be constant. We just saw that the velocity that it's shooting out at has to be 8.85 meters per second. Cancel that. And when we solve for this, we find that the radius has to be 0.0124 meters. And then the final question I kind of added on there, we want to know if I wanted to go higher, so higher than 4 meters, should I make the area bigger or should I make the area smaller? So which one should I do? So what I'm going to do is kind of think backwards. So if we're thinking about kinematics, if I want my height to be larger, what I want to do is I want to shoot this out at a higher velocity. I need a higher initial velocity in order to get my object to go higher. If you think about just throwing a ball up, if you want your ball to move up higher in the air, you have to throw it faster. So we need a larger velocity. And then we just said, based on this continuity equation, if we have a constant volume flow rate, has to be conserved. If we want a larger velocity, we need to have a smaller area. So our area needs to be smaller. And then if our area is smaller, the way to do that is to have a smaller radius. So kind of following these logical, I guess, steps, in order to get more height, we have to have a larger velocity. In order to have a larger velocity, we need to have a smaller area. In order to have a smaller area, we need a smaller radius. And this is because we have a constant volume flow rate because of the conservation of mass.